Okay, welcome everyone to week number 5. We're actually over halfway through at this point. This week's lecture is going to be on intermediate JavaScript. And what I generally mean by that is that we're going to be learning lots of new tools that we can use with JavaScript. And we're also going to be talking about getting data from servers, and in general, just a little bit more about what servers are, how we interact with servers. So that's this lecture. Okay, so last week's homework, we've been talking about DOM manipulation. So we had some practice with manipulating these elements in HTML and CSS that we've been writing in week 0 and 1 with the JavaScript that we've been using in weeks 2 through 4. So this is actually like the real function of JavaScript. We're actually getting to change something on the page programmatically using the code that we write with JavaScript. So hopefully that's starting to seem quite cool. And if you did the bonus homework last week, then you might have actually made a real application, which is a really huge step forward. We get an entire application that we can build on a web browser. If you have some extra time and you haven't checked it out yet, I would definitely give that a go. It was a really cool homework. Okay, so this week's lecture, as I said, mostly just getting some more tools in your toolbox to make your life easier. Mainly just new syntax with JavaScript as I said, makes things easier. I'm going to be introducing Object Orientated Programming, which is a really complicated sounding thing. Basically just restructuring our code into units that we can work with. More on that later. And then finally, we'll be talking about how to load data from an external server, an external API, and be able to show that in our website. So this first section here, all about new tools. I think I mentioned this either last lecture or the lecture before. You pretty much have everything that you could possibly need to know in order to express pretty much anything in JavaScript. You might have quite an inefficient, quite long-winded program that you might be writing with your JavaScript using lots of if-else conditions, and it might seem kind of messy. But you can do pretty much anything that you can imagine. You probably have to trust me on that at the moment, because maybe it doesn't seem like you can do anything that you can imagine. But this lecture's new tools is all about making your life as easy as possible, being able to write JavaScript that just looks nicer, that's easier to write. So this is this section as a whole. Most of these came with the most recent update of JavaScript. So there was this big update in 2015 called ES6. ES stands for ECMAScript, which is the European Computers Manufacturing Organization Association. So that's another word for JavaScript, basically. This is just a version of JavaScript. And there were some big upgrades to JavaScript that made everyone's life a lot easier. So yeah, I'll be sort of whizzing through all of these. You'll get some opportunities to practice this in the homework this week with some free code camp exercises. So if it doesn't make sense now, then hopefully going through those yourself will make this a lot easier. Okay, so the first thing that I want to introduce is something called arrow functions. So far we've been writing code that looks something like this. This is a function expression. So we have an anonymous function. We haven't given it a name. These are the two arguments, and this is the code that runs when we call that function. And we're just storing that in a value. So that's what we call a function expression. We're storing it as a value in a variable. And then we can just call that variable as if we're calling a function. So this is sort of like the old way of doing things. We're really verbose by saying the word function. It's quite easy to see what's going on here, hopefully. But we have this other shorthand on the right that we can use instead, where we basically just cut off this word function And then we have like this fat arrow syntax. So it's like an equal sign and then a greater than sign in the shape of an arrow, basically. And this just sort of replaces the old syntax. And these two are just totally functionally equivalent. The nice thing about doing it like this is that if you are just straight up just returning something straight away, so in this case, we're just adding A and B together and returning it, we can actually get rid of this this curly bracket and the word return. So we can actually turn this into just one line, which is really nice. At first, it might seem kind of annoying having to learn this new syntax, but it really saves a lot of space, makes the code look a lot nicer, makes it feel a lot nicer to write, because you're writing so much less extra syntax that you don't really need. So this is a really nice little hack. This again came in 2015. So before then, all code looked like this before. So that's arrow functions. Next, I want to talk about the ternary operator. This is a really nice little tool just to make our lives easier. We might come into these situations where we have some sort of variable that we want to set based on a condition. So we can see in this pane on the left here, we have this text variable. So we're creating a box, we're just putting it to empty. And we want to say, okay, if this condition is true, so we have, one is less than some value that we're tracking, or we have, okay, this variable and this variable are both true. So we have some sort of Boolean condition. We want to say, okay, I want to put this thing in this box if that condition is true. Otherwise, I want to put this thing in that box. This is a really common use case for something that we need to do quite regularly. And it's like, you know, 6 lines of code, which is quite annoying. It turns out that we can use what's called the ternary operator, and we can fit it all in one line. So the way to read this is, okay, we're creating a box called text. And inside that box, we're going to say, okay, if that condition is true, then the first thing. If that condition is false, then the second thing. So this probably takes quite a while to get used to this. I know for me, it took ages to get to used to this, and I had to keep looking things up. But it's just a huge time saver if you know that you need to do something exactly like this. The easiest way to do it is just, okay, I'm going to look up, oh, how does the ternary operator work in JavaScript? And then you'll find the syntax. Or you can come to the lecture notes and find that here, which will save a lot of time. Okay, so next, template strings. This is a really nice one as well. So I think we've mentioned this a couple of times where we want to create a long sentence with variables injected. So for example, we want to say, okay, hey, I'm my name and I'm my age years old, let's say. So before we had to concatenate each of these snippets together. And what's quite annoying with that is that we also have to worry about where the spaces are. So we have one space here where between I'm and the name, and then we have another space that we need to remember to put in between the name and. And I actually forgot the final space here. So this would automatically sort of mess my code up, but it's super easy to do this. The way that we can do this in the newest syntax is that instead of using two apostrophes, what do you call this? Quotation marks. Instead of using quotation marks or apostrophes, if you use backticks for the strings, which works in exactly the same way, if you use backticks, then you can directly inject variables into this string without having to concatenate anything together. So this is just sort of a shorthand way of doing the same thing that we were doing before, except it's way easier to read. So the way to do this is that we just put a dollar sign and then curly brackets around whatever variable, and then that'll just inject that string directly where it's supposed to be in the line of text that we're creating. So that's a really nice one, a really useful one to get to know. Okay, next thing. We have something called object destructuring. So object destructuring, we often want to grab certain properties off of an object to use them in our code somewhere. So we might have something like we have on the left here. We have this object called Adam. I need to use Adam's name somewhere. I need to use Adam's age, and I need to use Adam's likes array. So usually we would have to create new variables that just point to the exact same thing, which is kind of boring and repetitive. We don't like to do repetitive things in coding. So we always want to try and find a way to save space. And it turns out that we can use this syntax on the right here to do the exact same thing. So the way to read this is that we're creating three new boxes, and using this curly brackets notation around the side of the names, it's saying, okay, go into this thing on the right. We're assuming that it's an object, and I want to destructure these three fields off of that object. So if this doesn't make total sense, don't worry about it right now. But the huge win is that we just get to use these three variables in the rest of our code. So these two are exactly functionally equivalent, except this line right here is one line, and these lines right here is three lines. So it's a little bit cleaner, it's a little bit nicer to use. And hopefully you'll see the benefit of using this as you gradually write more and more JavaScript. Super similar as well, we also have array destructuring. So again, if we wanted to get a few different values from an array into different variables and name each of those variables, we might have to do something like this on the left, which again just takes up way too many lines. We can do the same thing that we did with object destructuring instead, except with array destructuring, we just need to use the square brackets. And hopefully that makes sense, because arrays are sort of syntactically involve square brackets, whereas objects involve curly brackets. So same thing again, we can just grab the zeroth, first, and second item in the array from an array. We just need to use this exact syntax. Don't worry about memorizing the syntax, just look it up. And hopefully this saves a lot of space and a lot of time. Okay, next thing, when we have functions that take arguments, we can give those arguments a default value now. So in this case, let's say we wanted to call this function add1. And the way that this function works is that it takes a number as an argument, and it just gives us back that number plus one. So if we try to call this function with no arguments, with nothing inside of these parentheses here, then we'd get back NaN, because when this function gets run, this number, because we haven't given it an argument, because we haven't passed anything in, this num value would be undefined, and we'd be returning undefined plus one, which doesn't make sense. You can't add undefined to a number. So we get back NaN, which maybe that breaks our program because we're trying to do something with the output here later in the program, possibly. So the great thing with using default values is that we can say, okay, if somebody doesn't put a value for this particular argument, so if we just call add1 with no arguments, it's expecting something, this function will fall back to taking this default value that we have on the right here. So in this case, we just do add1. We haven't given a value, so it takes the default value. So in the end, we get 0 plus 1, which is a number, and hopefully that doesn't crash our code later on because we're trying to add something again to something that doesn't exist. So this can be really useful. This is a nice thing to know. Checking for this before we had this syntax was a bit tougher. So this is just a really nice shortcut to be able to know about. Okay, I think there are only a couple more of these little tools that we have left. Again, I am really speeding through these as quickly as possible. The best way to learn these properly is to actually do them with practice. So you'll get the chance to do that in the homework this week. This next one is a nice little shorthand for creating objects. In this example here on the left, this is basically the only example that this ever comes up as. We might have a situation where we're creating an object with a list of properties that equal some variables that we set earlier. So in this case, in our code, we might be saying, okay, we have a name called Adam. Maybe we got that from an input. Maybe that came from an API, which we'll talk about later. We have an age, which is a number, and we have an array of likes. If we wanted to create an object that contained each of those fields, we might have to do something like this. So we're creating a name property, we're setting it to the value of our name variable. We're creating an age property, we're setting that age value to the value of this age variable. And the likes property is coming from the likes variable. It turns out with ES6, with code that's been written since 2015, we have this really nice shorthand where if the property name and a variable name are the same, we can just wipe out the second part of this property initialization. So we can just use the name of the variable and it will just sort of convert it to what's on the left here. So that's also just a nice one. Like sometimes that works quite well. Most often, this is more one of these niche ones that just makes things a tiny bit nicer to write, but aren't super important. Okay, next we have the spread, otherwise known as the rest operator. If we add three decimal points before an object or an array, that sort of spreads out its contents and gives us that in a value. So I'll show this in terms of an example again, just to make this super clear. Let's say that we have this new object that we want to create called new Adam, and we essentially just want to take all the fields in this object called Adam and all the fields in this object called more Adam, and we want to create a mega object that just has all of these fields together. To do this previously, we might have to do something like this. So every one of these properties we're setting with this object's name property, this object's age property. And you can imagine that this might get extremely tedious if there are 100 different properties of each of these objects that we want to smush together. With the spread operator on the right, we're wrapping everything in curly braces. So we're creating a new object and putting these three dots before these two names is essentially saying, okay, I want everything that's inside of these curly braces to be injected right there and everything inside of these curly braces to be injected right there. So this is a huge time saver in a case where you might have, you know, like 20 fields in two different objects. If it turns out that there's the same variable that gets added twice, so maybe both of these objects might have a name field, then the way that we resolve that is that the most recent spreaded object that we use sort of overwrites the first one. So if these both had the name, both had different names, then we'd take the second one's name because that was added to the object last. Okay, similar operator for arrays as well. So here we have two arrays. We want to push these together. We could use a loop over one of the arrays and then push each item to a new array. That's one way of doing it. But a really nice shorthand in ES6 is to use a spread operator. So again, we're saying, okay, I want to create a new array with the two square brackets. And then I can just use the spread operator for likes here to say, okay, everything in this likes array, I want to put that at the start, and then everything inside of more likes after that. So this just gives us like a complete array with all the contents of the first array and the second array together. So that's super handy. Okay. Last thing I want to talk about in terms of the tools that we're learning today that make our lives easier. We already talked about some prototype methods that we get for free with arrays. We didn't call them prototypes. So this is maybe a little bit new. With arrays, also with objects, with pretty much anything in JavaScript, we tend to get a list of different methods and properties that we get for free. So we've seen some of these already. We've seen the push prototype method. It just sort of comes with an array. If we have an array, we know that we can use this push method because secretly the array is an object, as we mentioned, I think two lectures ago. But there are a few other ones that also come in useful that I want to talk about. So it turns out we can actually look at all of the prototype methods that come with an array, that come with anything. If we do a console log of something, there's often this double underscore proto double underscore thing that will show up that maybe somebody noticed before. And this has all of the free methods that we get from a particular class of thing. So we can see pushes here. This is one of the free ones that we get. There's also one called pop, which I think just releases like the last one. So like pops one off of the array. But there's a huge long list of these that you could know about. But the one that I want to talk about, the few that I want to talk about is the array.forEach method. So the forEach method is one of these ones that we get for free. If we have an array, it turns out we can use this .forEach function, and that will do something to each element in the array. So I want to give an example here. So we had this situation a couple of lectures ago where we have an array of objects, and we want to loop over this array of objects, and we want to do something for each element in that array, for each object in that array. So, you know, we had a big list of people. The first one is Jolene, and she has auburn hair. So we're going to loop through the array of people. And we had this big, long, awful for loop that we had to write every time you wanted to do this. We grabbed the particular person by using the current index of our people array. So first time running through, we have I equals zero. The person is people zero, which is the first one in people, which is Jolene. And since we have this person variable here with this Jolene object, we can make a console log of, okay, my name is person name Jolene, and I have person hair, auburn hair. And this will just run through every item in the array and do that for every person in our people list. So this is really annoying to work with. I hope you will appreciate just how annoying the syntax was. Having forced some of you to do this syntax with a real example in the hash pyramid bonus homework 2 weeks ago, if you actually tried that out, then hopefully you'll have a real passion for understanding why this syntax is particularly bad. We have this great solution where we can use the forEach method of an array instead. And that essentially just does the exact same thing. So the way that this works is the forEach method takes a function. That function has an argument. And then inside that function is some code that we're going to run for every item in the array in order. So again, you know, the first time this runs, it takes the first element in the array. Then for that first element, we have the object or the thing that we're looking at. That ends up being the argument. And we can do the same thing again, just logging out, okay, my name is person.name. So first time around, it's Jolene. The next time, it's Emily or whatever. And I have person.hair. This should be auburn hair. So this is really, really powerful stuff for making our life so much easier. This is so much easier than doing things on the left. and so much cleaner as well. And it just reads better. It's just like, okay, this particular array, for each item in that array, I want to do this thing inside of these brackets here. So there are three other methods that get used a lot, which are prototype methods of arrays. Three methods that I want you guys to look at. The first two, I think, are particularly important, especially for the stuff that we're going to be doing with React from next week. Array.map is pretty much the same as array.forEach. With array.forEach, we're just doing something for every array, for every element in the array. Array.map is mutating that element, mutating every element in the array and returning something different. So for example, we could have a map function that adds one to every value in an array of numbers, for example. So we could put in, okay, 1, 2, 3, and it'll give us back 2, 3, 4. It's a really powerful method to sort of mutate entities in our code and spit out something else. We use this a lot, especially in React. And then array.filter. So same sort of thing with array.forEach. We're giving it a function. We're looking at a particular element in an array. And the deal with filter is that if we return true, then that particular item stays in a new array that gets made. And if we return false, then we kick this element out and that doesn't come in the new array. So that one's nice. And array.reduce is even more complicated. We're basically running through every item in an array and then we're constructing some new thing that is sort of created by this, created by doing something with each item in the array. If that sounds complicated, it is quite complicated. You don't necessarily need to use this, but this is sort of like a top tier, like next level thing to be good at using array.reduce and especially these array prototype methods. So there will be some videos in this week's homework. I'm not sure if I want to put them in the regular homework or the bonus homework. There's an awesome guy called with a channel called Fun Fun Functions, which explains this stuff really well, way better than I can possibly explain it. So I would recommend taking a look at these videos that I put into the homework this week if you want to learn how to get really good at these prototype methods. Okay, so that was all of the new tools that we're adding in terms of JavaScript. This next section should be kind of similar. The next section, I think another way of calling it is Object Orientated Programming, which is this really long, complicated sounding thing that I talked about earlier. But essentially what OOP, Object Oriented Programming, is all about is we're defining things in the real world in terms of objects, and we're organizing things in a nicer way than having to rewrite things every time. So I'm going to give a little bit of an example of that. There's also a fantastic meme here that I found. I think you need to learn a little bit more about other programming languages to really get this. But I think NCC doesn't really have objects in it, or it doesn't really do OOP. So yeah, how do we get more women into computer science? Stop treating them like objects, and he gets thrown out the window, which is, I really like memes. Okay, so objects. First of all, I want to talk about exactly what an object is. As I said in a previous lecture, I think objects are really important in JavaScript, and almost every type that we have to work with, every complex type at least, like an array, is an object. Also the document is an object. The console is an object. Most of the things that we're working with aren't one of the five primitive data types that I talked about are secretly objects under the hood, even if we don't think that they're objects. So that's one way of thinking about objects. Like, yeah, we can run code in JavaScript using these objects. But what's quite a nice thing to do is to be able to model something in the real world as an object. So we can see that we did this a few slides ago where we had this list of people. And we have this element in an array, which is an object, which is sort of representing the idea of Jolene. So, you know, we have a list of properties that sort of express what it's like to be Jolene. You know, she has auburn hair and her name is Jolene. You know, maybe she's 18 years old or whatever. So we can sort of model these things in the real world in terms of objects. And then we can make programs that sort of do things with these things that map to the real world in a way that's quite useful a lot of the time. So for example here, let's say, okay, we want to model some different fruits. So I want to be able to talk about an apple and I want to be able to talk about a banana. You know, maybe we have some sort of e-commerce shop where we're managing inventory of our store and we've got, you know, a certain number of apples, a certain number of bananas, and we want to be able to track things. So here, you know, maybe we can sort of describe these two things as objects. So, you know, we have an object's name, we have, let's say, like a sweetness value, taste, let's say, and we have like a shape. And these are all sort of properties that describe what the thing is like. And then we also could give these objects methods. So again, a method is just a function that we're putting on an object. So an object, again, you sort of think about this as like a mega variable, which is sort of like a big box with multiple boxes inside, and we can just create as many boxes inside that box as we want, which is quite useful. We could say, okay, we can put some functions onto one of these objects. So we could say we have like an eat function, maybe that sort of destroys the apple, destroys the apple, let's say, like throwing it, maybe like hit someone. We can sort of model these things as interacting in a virtual world that affect other objects, which can be quite useful. So we might want to write some code like this, which might implement these fruit objects, these fruit ideas in the real world as objects. So we have an apple here and it's an object and we have the properties. And then we have these two methods. When we call apple.eat with two parentheses, when we invoke this eat method, we get a console log with someone saying, it's gone. Or we could throw it and, you know, somebody's yelling, take this. And we might want to do the same thing with banana, but banana has a different taste and different shape. We can access each of these properties using the dot notation, as we saw a couple lectures ago. And we can invoke one of these methods in the same sort of way that we would use invoke a function, because a method essentially is just a function. But you might be looking at this code and see that there's something kind of wrong, because we're essentially just copy and pasting both of these methods between different objects, which is bad. Remember this primary programming principle of don't repeat yourself. We really like to stick with that in programming. We want to write dry code, don't repeat yourself code. We don't want to write wet code, which is where we have to write every time. We want things to be dry. So we need to find a way of doing this, being able to express different objects and work with these different objects in our files without having to rewrite common functionality. So the way that we do this is using something called a class. And classes in JavaScript essentially allow us to create some functionality that another object can sort of inherit from this class, which is sort of like a parent or an ancestor. So in this fruit analogy, again, we create a class called fruit. And then from that class, we can create object instances. So we create objects of a class fruit, and then we can add the individual properties to that class. So JavaScript is actually kind of different to other object-oriented languages. JavaScript isn't actually an object-oriented language, but we've sort of used this class thing as kind of syntactic sugar on top of our regular JavaScript to make our lives easier. So a way to think about classes and objects is that a class is sort of like a template or like a blueprint of how an object should look. So we can think of it as like a cookie cutter and a cookie. So a class is the cookie cutter. It says, okay, I want this cookie to look like a pumpkin, let's say. The cookie cutter is very different from the end result of the cookie. So you couldn't eat the cookie cutter, but you can use it as a template to make things that you could eat. So it's quite important to sort of vaguely be aware of this difference between a class and an object. We can also call an object a class instance, an instance, but object is maybe an easier term to know about, because it's really clear what an object looks like. So I'm going to sort of quickly run through what the syntax looks like for creating these classes and then doing things with these classes. So we declare a class quite similarly to declaring a function. We just use the keyword class and the name of class. By convention, we always capitalize the name of classes just to make it easier to figure out what we're talking about. And we just have two curly brackets where all of our class code goes inside. Creating a new class, we use the new keyword in JavaScript, N-E-W, and then the name of the class and then two parentheses. And you might see these two parentheses and think, oh, that looks like we're invoking a function. And actually, it turns out that we are invoking a function when we use this new syntax with the name of a class. And that function is a special function called a constructor function. So the constructor function is what gets run the first time we create a new instance of the class. And it turns out that we can also pass arguments to the constructor function. So in this case, we're creating a new fruit and we're passing in the name of banana. And when we make this new fruit like this, the constructor function is going to get called. The name we're passing in as this string of banana. So it takes this and it says, oh, okay, there's a console log. So I'm going to console log out, I am a banana. So it's actually not that useful for us to be able to just write a console log of whatever we pass in. So a really common pattern that we want to do is to set properties of this particular class instance. And the way that we do that is that we have this special keyword in JavaScript called this, which refers to the current cookie that the cookie cutter is making, essentially. So here we're saying, okay, I want to make a new fruit. And in my constructor method now, I have three arguments, which is the name of the fruit, the taste of the fruit, and the shape of the fruit. And this time when I'm calling my new fruit statement, I'm passing in banana for the name, semi-sweet for the taste, and then arc for the shape. And then calling these three lines here is saying, okay, go into this new cookie that I'm just creating, go into it and set the name property of this new cookie to the name that we're passing in. And then we're doing the same thing for all three of the arguments that we're passing in. And then once we've run this code, we're saving this new class instance, this new object into this variable called banana. And then after that, we're then able to access these properties using the dot notation, just like with any other object. So that's quite useful. One thing I would say is that the this keyword in JavaScript can often mean different things at different times. I'm not sure if I actually had a... Yeah, that's the same image. Okay. It can mean different things at different times. It's basically saying, okay, whatever is currently in scope. So what level am I within the code? So it could refer to the window object. This is quite common. If there's nothing that it's sort of inside of, if it's not sort of inside a function that's running, usually if that's the case, then that would be this. So this can mean lots of different things in JavaScript, but don't worry about it too much. This is one application where this can mean something. We'll be seeing some more examples of this when we talk about React as well. This is a nice simple use case where I think this makes quite a lot of sense. Okay, and we can also write methods on these classes, which look almost identical to declaring a function in regular JavaScript. We just give a name of a method that we want to add to a particular cookie that we're creating. And then this will run in a super similar way to when we're calling properties. We can call these functions outside of our object, and it knows what it's talking about. And again, we can use the this keyword inside of these methods, and it will grab the current value of the current object that we're looking at, which is a really nice feature. So here, for example, we have this eat method that we're creating, and we're grabbing the name and the taste from the current value of the object. And we're then logging out, this banana in this case tastes semi-sweet. And this is really, really useful. We can also update values of the current cookie that we created using these methods. We can even interact with other cookies outside of the current instance of the current cookie. So we can start to see all sorts of complicated interactions that we can replicate using these objects, using object-oriented programming in general. Okay. So we can gradually add more and more complexity onto these classes. Here's an example where we are tracking a property called eaten. So originally the property of eaten is false, like there's a new banana or a new apple that hasn't been eaten yet. And we're saying, okay, when we call this eat method, if this fruit hasn't already been eaten, then we're gonna console log, this fruit tastes, whatever the taste is. And then we're gonna set the current value of eaten to true. And then the next time that we call this method, eaten is gonna be true. So we'll hit this else condition here and we'll say, oh, I already ate the banana in this case. So we can gradually add more and more complexity on these classes to do some really cool and interesting stuff. So everything together, we have something like this. We have the constructor method. The constructor method is going to execute when we use this new keyword, passing in whichever arguments we want. And then we can define as many more methods as we want, which are basically like functions that we're attaching to each object, essentially. Okay, so that's everything to do with the new syntax in JavaScript and everything to do with the classes and the objects. As always, you'll learn this stuff a lot better just by actually practicing. So don't worry if this sounds like complete nonsense so far. It's a totally, totally normal, totally okay reaction to having lots of new jargon thrown at you all at once. The last thing I want to talk about today is loading data, which is a really common thing that we do as developers. So you might recall way back in the first lecture, week zero, I talked about front end and back end. Pretty much everything we've been doing so far in this course has been front end orientated. So we're displaying how a website looks with HTML and CSS. And even when we're writing JavaScript code, this is still purely on the front end because it's all about presentational logic. So when a user clicks on this button, this thing should happen. This is still like front end work. But we also have this whole sphere of knowledge called backend programming, which we're going to be talking about in the last couple of lectures of this course. And in backend programming, we're setting up these servers, which essentially are serving up pieces of data, serving up web pages, serving up all sorts of things, interacting with databases, just handling all this sort of business logic that we as front-end developers are merely displaying to the end user. So I'm going to be talking about APIs. API is quite a complex word that can mean lots of different things at once. I have a nice little analogy that's hopefully helpful figuring out what an API is. I'm going to introduce JSON really quickly, which is a data format that we tend to use for requesting things from servers. I'm going to talk about asynchronous versus synchronous code, which explains why we need to use something called a promise. And then finally, I'm going to be talking about, okay, how do we actually make a request using JavaScript? How do we grab some data from a server? And then how can we use that data in our site using JavaScript? And then one more thing, I want to talk about async await, which is an awesome new ES6 feature that specifically makes sense in terms of data loading. Okay, so lots of things still to cover. I mentioned that this was going to be a little bit longer of a lecture. Okay, so first of all, I want to talk about what an API is. An API stands for an application programming interface. So you might remember way back in week zero, we talked about abstraction. And we said that when you're driving a car, there's an interface that you know about, which is you can turn the wheel left and the car goes left, or you can press the brake pedal and the car stops. An interface is just, okay, how do I interact with something? What's the normal way of me interacting with this thing? And typically, there are sort of two different ways that we could think about APIs, two different ways that we can sort of use interchangeably. We can talk about, okay, Facebook has an open API that we can use. It's actually not that open anymore since the Cambridge Analytica scandal back in 2016. But back in the day, you could make a request to Facebook's API, you could get a certain set of permissions, and then you could request information about your friends, about yourself, about what groups you're in, stuff like that. So in that case, an API is the way that you interact with Facebook's backend to get some data. The set of things that you need to do, the turning of the steering wheel or the shoving of the brake pads. So that's an API in that case, but we can also talk about APIs in terms of just using our server. So, you know, the backend developer that works on your team or yourself, if you're a full stack developer, creates a server and that server has an API. There's a way of using that server. There's a way of interfacing with that server to get some data. So that's sort of a general overview of APIs. I always thought APIs were an extremely confusing topic. So hopefully that clears things up a little bit. And we can go into some examples of exactly what an API looks like. Okay, so an API is the interface for interacting with the backend. We're always talking with a server with an HTTP request. So we always use HTTP requests whenever we want to talk to a server, talk to a backend. And the server is always going to give us back an HTTP response. So we had a diagram similar to this way back in week zero, where essentially, okay, the computer, our client, the client side is going to make an HTTP request to a server, which looks something like this, and the server gives back a response. So we had this example of a GET request, where it's like, okay, give me a cat. You know, I'm just typing into my browser some address where a cat picture lives. And what happens is there's an HTTP request that says, okay, give me the cat. And the server responds with a response, which is the image of the cat that we were looking for. So that's one type of request that we can make, which is called a GET request. So a GET request, it does what it says. You make a request to this URL and it gives you back something. So that's a GET. But there's lots of other methods that we can use. So GET is one way that we can interact with an API. We can also send an HTTP POST request, which typically involves creating some new thing on the back end. So when we create a new Facebook account, you put in your email and your password and your name, whatever else Mark Zuckerberg needs, and it'll create a new account on Facebook's backend. And then the next time you log in, you can add your credentials to request and you'll get back a feed that is sort of catered to yourself. So a post request is another type of request. We can also use a patch request, which involves editing an existing thing. So if you were changing some information on your Facebook profile, that would use a patch request. A put request is almost the same as a patch request, except we're replacing the thing. So really subtly different. Lots of times a backend won't have both of these methods. They'll just sort of choose one or the other. But you can also have both of these in one server. That also makes sense. And there's also the delete method. So that's another sort of HTTP method that we can use, where if we give a particular resource ID, we can delete that resource from the backend. If you press the button somewhere in Facebook to delete your account, then that would trigger a delete request to Facebook's backend, and Facebook's backend would receive that and delete the row in the database, the row in the spreadsheet of all the users of Facebook where you previously were, and would just wipe that row out so that you can't sign in again. So we have these different methods: get, post, patch, put, delete. There's also something called a route, which is basically the type of request you're making plus a particular URL. And generally, they all follow the same sort of pattern. So if you make a GET request to some resource name, so we have users, which sort of maps to a table of users. If we just have a request like that, then typically the behavior is, okay, I want to get all of the users on the website. Just give me the entire table, basically. If we use a POST method, with a route like this, then we'll be expecting to say, okay, make a new user. So give me some information and make one of these resources, this resource of user. If we have some numbers on the end of it or an ID on the end of it, then generally we're saying, okay, get me the user with this ID. That's super common. And then patch and delete. Yeah, we're saying, okay, I'm passing in this number into the URL. I want you to either edit or delete that particular user. So to me, this was always really confusing. There's this word called method, there's this word called route, like API, I wasn't even sure about this until embarrassingly recently. But I have a nice little analogy that hopefully makes some sense. And let me know if this actually makes sense, because I've made this up totally by myself. So I think like an API is sort of like a franchise of restaurants. So you can think of like McDonald's, or you can think about a company that owns lots of different types of restaurants. I think would be a better example, but I need to flesh this metaphor out a little bit. So an API is essentially a chain of restaurants, and the chain is mysite.com, whatever the name of my site is. That's sometimes referred to as the domain. So the domain is sort of like the like flagship name of the site. So if you're on facebook.com again, the domain is facebook.com, but the URL or the address is facebook.com/home or whatever, or slash newsfeed. So the domain is like the brand name of the franchise. And it turns out that the franchise can have many different locations. It can have many different addresses. So you could think about, okay, if I go to mysite.com/articles, then we go to like the articles restaurant where everything to do with articles happens. And you can think about this in terms of like a drive-through. So when you go through a drive-through at McDonald's, there are different windows that behave different ways. So you could think, okay, there's a post window at McDonald's where you give some information about what you want to eat. So, you know, like two cheeseburgers, some fries, McFlurry or whatever. And there's a person on the other side of that window that takes that order and prepares it and sort of sets in motion a chain of events, which will later give you your McDonald's meal that you want. And then there's essentially like a get window as well, where you're picking up the order that you placed before. So we can sort of think about this as like, okay, there are these different windows, and the windows have different names on them. So the name of the window is like the method. And every one of these stores can have as many of these windows as we want. There's a maximum of 5, like there's no other methods than these 5 here. We can't create just another name of a window and put that there. That doesn't work. But we have these windows that come with every one of these restaurants to choose from. And there's a general behavior that's agreed upon for each of these windows. Now, it is possible to create a server that totally disregards the conventions of what the name on the window is. So we could write a server that lives at the get route that belongs to this get window that deletes the article that you give it, for example. That would be generally kind of a stupid thing to do for obvious reasons. If you're sort of sharing your API with other developers on your team, or you know, if like Facebook, you have like an open API, which anyone can access. That would be kind of a dumb thing to do. So in general, we stick to these simple conventions. You know, if there's just the sort of the name of the resource that relates to the database table, like here, we're saying, you know, we're calling this branch of the franchise articles, then get will return all the articles. Post is going to create a new one of the articles. Or if we have, you know, a particular resource of articles, so we're looking at, okay, articles /123. This is the restaurant that's all about this particular article. Then get will just return that particular article. Patch and put will edit that particular article, and delete will delete that particular article. Okay, so every time that we set up one of these routes on the back end, we're essentially creating a new one of these restaurants, and each of these restaurants is sort of separate. And the route is like one particular window at one particular restaurant. So in our example here, where we have articles and then we have articles /123, we have two different URLs that we're setting up. We have two different API endpoints, is another word for this, the address. And we have a total of 6 different methods that we can use, 6 different ways to interact with this server. Okay. Yeah, and the root is the name of, okay, one particular window at one particular restaurant. Okay, so hopefully that's helps a little bit in terms of visualizing what this looks like, because I think APIs are really common, but also really useful and important thing to know about. So hopefully that clears it up at least a little bit. Next thing I want to talk about is JSON, which is short for JavaScript Object Notation. So when we make a GET request, the format of the data that comes back is usually in something called JSON, which looks something like this. And the deal with JSON is that it's almost exactly like an array of objects. Or it could also just be an object purely on its own. But yeah, it looks almost identical to an object. So just think of this as an object, basically. But it's a nice system to work with. It's a nice data type to work with, because JavaScript knows how to deal with objects. Another way that we could possibly wire up a server is for a server to return CSV files. So CSV is like comma separated values. It's like the same sort of values that you have on a spreadsheet. But immediately if we had sort of like data in a spreadsheet form, we'd need to sort of mutate that into an object. So a nice thing is that we can just immediately have an object or an array that we can work with. And most servers will return data in a format like this. So I have an example here. There's a site called JSON Placeholder, which I think we're gonna use in next week's homework, which really nicely sort of mocks a server that you can make dummy requests to. So for example, we have all of these different routes. So we have get posts, which is, okay, give me all of the posts that we have on the back end. And we get a big JSON document that looks like this. Now, I have a special browser extension called JSON Viewer that makes these a little bit nicer. But actually, I think if we refresh the page, we can see sort of like for like a millisecond, we can see how it usually looks, which is just sort of a little bit plainer. Okay, but essentially when we go to this website here, this address, our browser is automatically making a GET request when we put something into the URL bar. So we're going to this particular, address, this particular endpoint, and we're making a request to the GET terminal, essentially. And what's happening on jsonplaceholder.tippycode.com is that there's some programming code that's sort of simulating a human on the other side of that window. And they're taking this request of give me all the posts, and they'll give you back this data in a JSON format. So that's JSON. We'll be getting more and more used to that as we actually deal with making requests. Okay, next thing I want to talk about is asynchronous versus synchronous operations. This is like a really complicated few slides. Don't worry about it if you don't really understand this. It's not really that important. At the end of these few slides, we'll get a snippet of code that will make a request to a server. So if you totally tune out for the next 3 minutes, then that's totally okay. You don't really need to understand this, but it's good just to have a little bit of background. So JavaScript, when it reads a file, we said this already, JavaScript goes through one line at a time, executes the first statement, second statement, third statement, blah, blah, blah. So one way of describing this is that JavaScript is single-threaded in that it can only do one thing at a time. There are other languages out there which can do two different things at one time and will more efficiently be able to crunch different lines of code in different places and doesn't need to wait for an opportunity to be able to do this one thing on this one thread. So we can think about it like this, like there's like a thread, a string, and JavaScript is going to move through each statement and execute each statement in turn. We can have a situation where one of these statements takes some amount of time to resolve. It's not instant. And a statement like this, we call an asynchronous statement, an asynchronous operation. And with a single-threaded language, if we have some statement that takes some time to resolve, then this statement will block the entire program. So with data loading, we can imagine this as, okay, we have these three console logs, and we also have this fetch data function. The fetch data function has to make a request to some server, which is maybe on the other side of the planet. Maybe it takes some while for the request to travel down the computer router to the cable under the ocean to go all the way to another continent to grab the cat picture that you're asking for. And then it also needs to reply. So it's some non-zero amount of time. And, you know, generally this could be anywhere from, you know, 100 milliseconds to a few seconds if there's a really large file that we're loading. And, you know, the default behavior is, okay, JavaScript's doing one thing at a time. It comes to an asynchronous statement. So it's a statement that doesn't reply immediately. And the whole program has to be blocked for this statement to continue and for us to get this last console log here. So the way that we get around this in JavaScript typically is that we have something called a callback function, which is a function that's going to execute once this asynchronous code completes. So in this case, we have the same thing that we had before, except this time we're passing in a callback function, and this fetch data function is going to wait until it gets some response back, and then it's gonna call what's in this function here. So in this case, we get something like this. So statement one happens immediately, console.log hey. Statement two, console.log hello. Statement three, it starts getting some data from the server. And then it immediately jumps on to the next statement. So we get console.log hola. And then once this data responds, as soon as that happens, we trigger this callback function, which console logs whatever the data was. So it console logs a picture of the cat, or it console logs some JSON data that we requested. So an example here of this in practice, why this is a problem. There's this method called setTimeout in JavaScript. It's one of these functions that we get totally for free from JavaScript as a language. And the deal with setTimeout is that it takes a function which is going to execute some code. So this is a callback function which executes some code, and it takes a number in milliseconds. And the deal is JavaScript's going to wait that many milliseconds, and then it's going to run this function. It's going to invoke the function that we gave it. So in this case, we just have these numbers counting up to 4, but this one is in the set timeout. So if we write this code into the browser, we get 4 happening before 3. And the reason for that is these operations 1, 2, and 4 are synchronous, but this operation is asynchronous. So JavaScript sees this, console log one logs immediately, console log two logs immediately. Set timeout is asynchronous, so it waits 2 milliseconds. But the only call that we trigger in this step is start waiting 2 milliseconds, and then once that 2 milliseconds is finished, then run this console log. So what we have is 1, 2, start the timeout, 4, timeout finishes, 3. So that's kind of the whole flow with these callback functions. So this used to be the way that we would code absolutely everything in JavaScript until 2015. And then with ES6, again, we got a solution to that. So something that people would always complain about with JavaScript is that we get this thing called callback hell, where we have some functions, let's say, we have like a data loading function, which expects a callback. We have a get user posts function, which is gonna make a request to the backend and then call a callback. We have get post comments, which does the same thing. And we have this common design pattern where we have functions that are grabbing data. And then once that function is complete, we run some code. And we'll almost always get code that looks something like this. So we have a function that's loading some data. It's going to grab the data, and then that data is going to be made available in a callback function in this argument. And then we're going to do something with that function. And something that's quite common is that we'll need to use a user's ID that we get from the backend from querying the user's database. And we need to get posts that that user has used, which means that we need to make a call to get user posts. And then we want to take this post ID and we want to stick it into this get post comments function, which is going to get all the comments for that particular post. And then finally, that's going to, we're going to use that comment ID to get a reply, all the replies on that comment of that post. So we get some code that just looks like this, which is kind of a mess. And it becomes increasingly messy the more of these things that we need to query in a row. And if we wanted to do error handling, which is also something that's quite common when we have this same sort of syntax. So with an error handling, we'll say, okay, if there was an error in loading this resource, then we get the second argument called error. And if there's an error, then we'll somehow escape the program. So it's just sort of another thing we need to do for every one of these resources. And eventually this looks just absolutely terrible. So we found a solution to this, which is something called a promise. And a promise is sort of similar in the sense that we have some sort of callback function that's going to execute if everything went all right. And the callback function we're putting inside of this then method. So the way to view this is probably seems way too abstract and not sort of concrete enough to actually do something with yet. But we have this function called getUsersData. And getUsersData is a function that we're going to write, which is going to make a request to our backend. And that function returns a promise. And the deal with a promise is that we have this method called then, where when we get that data back, we're going to execute the function that we pass into this method. So pretty much exactly the same as the callback function. And the nice thing with this is that we can chain lots of these promises together. So in this case, we're returning get user post, which is another function that we're writing ourselves, passing in that same user ID, and get user posts is also going to return a promise. So we can also use the then method on that result in the second then call here. And we can chain these along until finally we get the first reply that we were looking for originally back here. So this probably all seems extremely complicated right now, but really don't worry about it. All that we need is the tiny snippet of code right at the end. All of this information in the last 10 slides or so, it's purely for getting some sort of theoretical understanding of how that fits together. And it will be super useful if you actually start to use this in practice. And working with these promises becomes quite important. So one way to think about a promise is essentially, it's sort of like an unresolved thing that you can still pass around. So let's say we have a promise in real life. I go to the bank and I take out a loan, or I want to take out a loan. I want to buy a house. So I go to the bank and I say, okay, I want to buy a house. I don't really know which house I want to buy yet, but can I have a mortgage? The bank will write me a piece of paper that says, okay, you can have $200,000 to go and buy a house. I can then take that piece of paper and I can walk up to somebody who's selling a house and I can say, okay, this piece of paper is as good as the $200,000. I don't have that $200,000 yet, but I can still pass it around as if I had that $200,000. I don't need to first wait for the bank to give me the loan before I can start hunting for a house. I can do that already just having the promise of the money to buy the house. So again, that still seems kind of confusing, so don't worry about it. So this is what a promise looks like. This is how we would construct a promise. We don't tend to actually need to make promises ourselves, so don't worry about the syntax. But essentially, a promise is a class like anything else, so we can create a new one using the new keyword. And a promise takes a function which has two arguments, which are resolve and reject. And we whatever we pass into resolve is going to be the data that gets returned if everything goes okay, if we manage to ask for something from the server. So in this case, we have this function called getData, and we want to immediately return a promise. We would write some code to grab something from the backend, and then if that data exists, then we're going to resolve, which ultimately resolves the promise. And if we don't have anything from the backend, let's say we misspelled the URL, or if that resource got deleted, then we can reject with an object which might have an error message, for example. So a promise as a whole is something that has a state of either resolved, rejected, or pending. And the deal with resolved is, okay, it's the thing, the promise is resolved and we have the data that we're looking for. And immediately in our code that turns into something that we can use. Rejected means that, okay, we tried to get the data, but we couldn't find it. And pending means that we're still waiting for something to come back from the server. But the nice thing is that we can actually pass that promise value around in our code without blocking that single thread. So a nice way to do asynchronous programming, which is neater than callbacks. Then finally, we have this catch method, which means if this promise triggers a reject, if we get a rejected promise, then we jump directly to the code inside of this catch block, and then we can gracefully handle that error. So rather than having to do something super messy like this, where we need to check if there's an error at every single point, we can do that a lot cleaner just by having one catch statement right at the end. And this also works if there are multiple different then methods chained onto each other. Okay, so finally, so if we were totally baffled by the last 10 slides and feeling super scared, don't worry. I think it's much better to just start actually putting this stuff into practice and then worry about understanding things at a later date. So this is the code to grab something from a server. So we have this URL, which is api.myapp.com. So this is the domain. We're looking at the route address. So you could think about this as like, okay, there's one store which is called route. Maybe that's not the best word for it. And we want to grab that resource. So by default, we use this function called fetch. We get it for free from JavaScript. And by default, this tries to make a get request. So we're requesting the resource that is at this particular URL, and it's making a get request. But this returns a promise. So this is the key point. So just fetch api.myapp.com/route. This isn't a piece of data that we can use. This is a promise for a piece of data. So immediately when we run this line of code, fetch is going to make a request to the server. It takes some amount of time. And as that request is fulfilling, this is going to equal pending. When we finally get something resolved, either if it's resolved or if it's rejected, then we're going to jump into this then method right here. So if we get resolved with some data, then we get that response in this first argument here. We're calling it response. And this response is an HTTP object. So it's an object that represents the HTTP response. So it has things like meta information about the server, for example. Maybe it has stuff about when the request happened, stuff like this. But the important thing is that there's a method there on this object called JSON. There's the JSON method. And calling this also returns a promise, which is also super complicated. But this returns a promise which is going to resolve to the JSON data that came with that request. So if we just copy and paste this whole block of code here, we can remove this URL right here with any URL that we're trying to request from, and that will make a GET request to that particular address. And then inside of this second then call here, as long as everything went okay, we're gonna get back the value of this data. And if something went wrong, for instance, if we misspelled the route or if there was an internet connection problem, then we're gonna get this error message which Fetch gave us, which our backend, hopefully somebody on our backend actually implemented the error handling case. And in this case, we're just console logging the error, but maybe we wanna tell the user that an error happened. There's a few other things that maybe we wanna make happen instead. Okay, so that's making requests. That's the simple block of code that if you remember nothing else from this lecture, there is a block of code like this that you can copy and paste that makes a GET request. That's the most important thing. But it's still sort of kind of messy, this code, right? It doesn't really seem to make sense what's happening here. So this was like a common concern. So there's another syntax that we can use called async await. And again, it's not really a case of it being any. It's not like you can do anything that you couldn't do with promises with then and catch using async await. But it just makes things so much easier and more readable. So this is another way that you could write this to do the same thing, essentially. The deal with async await is that you need to mark the function that contains this code as async. So you have to add the word async before the word function. And you always have to wrap the await inside of a function. So if you just want to grab some data without wrapping it in a function, then you first need to wrap it in a function called getData and make that function asynchronous. But the deal is, okay, so we have the same fetch call with the same route here. So this returns a promise. But instead of using then, we can use this word await before the name of that promise. And what happens is the code that we're reading, the code that's been executed, is just going to wait at this line. So the response is waiting for this fetch to either resolve or reject. And then when it resolves, we store that value in this response variable. And then what we're doing here is the same thing that we were doing last time. So this response is an HTTP object representing the response, which has lots of different fields, one of which is this JSON method. So we're then calling that JSON method. That JSON method also returns a promise because it takes some time to format that data into the right shape. So then we're using the await syntax again to say, okay, when that resolves to either an error or to the data that we're looking for, we're going to store that value in this data variable. So again, like another way to do it, just easier, a little bit easier on the eyes, a little bit less code, is using this async await, but they basically do the exact same thing. Okay, so last thing I want to talk about today is what's called try catch blocks. And this is how we would do error handling with async await. So the deal is we have two blocks, try and catch. This might seem quite similar to the syntax that we have for if else. We write some code inside the try block. And if any of these statements create an error, then we'll immediately jump to this catch block and we'll have access to the error that got triggered. So this is how we would do error handling. Like we had this same catch method before, which is catching any errors that happened before this. We can do the same thing here with a try catch block. And we can have an unlimited number of different await calls trying to do things with data. If any one of them causes an error, we just get that one single error down here and then we can handle the error gracefully again. Okay, so that's everything for this week. That was a longer lecture than usual, as I mentioned. So this week, we have some videos from this awesome YouTube channel called Fun Fun Functions, which I'm going to be linking. And we'll also be doing some programming with Free Code Camp again, just to get some practice actually using this with some real code, some real scenarios that hopefully makes it a little bit easier to grasp some of these new pieces of JavaScript syntax that we've been introduced to. And then finally, with the bonus project, we're going to be making an e-commerce site this week if you decide to do the bonus homework. So as usual, just do the regular homework if you don't have time. But if you have more time, you want to learn some more, then we have lots of extra stuff that you can do to really practice getting this stuff in your heads. Okay, so that's it for this lecture.